Hello everyone, thank you for joining us today. Together with Mr. Ionuț Dumitru, Chief Economist at Raiffeisen Bank, we'll discuss about the macroeconomic outlook of Romania. Before we start, I will kindly ask you to set your microphones on mute during the speeches, to use the chat function in order to address your questions, or the raise hand function if you want to speak during the Q&A session. This webinar will be recorded and uploaded on our YouTube page afterwards. And I want to thank to the Raiffeisen team for their help and engagement shown to our community, and of course to Mr. Ionuț Dumitru for preparing this presentation for us. Mr. Dumitru, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you for your kind introduction. So first of all, hello everybody. I will focus my presentation on the most recent macroeconomic developments in Romania and of course on the outlook as well. I will start with the hottest topic these days, which is COVID. And basically, as we all know, in Romania, fortunately, the situation was kept under control. To be honest, personally, I was quite afraid at the beginning of the crisis that Romania will be affected very much, as everybody expected a lot of Romanians to come back home, especially from Italy and Spain. And we had in the last couple of weeks, in the last 2 months, more than 1 million Romanians coming back and crossing the border, most of them coming from Italy and Spain, and that was a big risk. But fortunately, the authorities put in place quite strict measures, and in the end, the situation was kept under control. As we can see from the numbers, the new COVID cases in the middle of the graph are on a downtrend. I think the trend is quite clear, but we should see what will happen in the next weeks once the restrictions will be gradually lifted, how the new cases will behave, and hopefully the downward trend will be maintained. At the same time, the number of deaths per 1 million inhabitants, it's a bit higher than in Hungary, for instance, but significantly lower than in Western countries, especially Italy and Spain, or even UK. And I think in the end, the situation again, fortunately, was kept under control for time being at least. Now the economy is reopening gradually. As we can see from the numbers, we don't have too much data on in real time, but we have the mobility indicators from Google or from Apple, for instance, showing that once the restrictions were enforced, the mobility collapsed. Now the mobility started to increase a bit, and this is the result of the decision of the authorities to lift the restrictions gradually, and now gradually we are coming back to a new normal, because the new normal is not the same normal from the pre-crisis period. And of course, having in mind the huge impact, not only at the healthcare sector level, but also at the economy level, all the governments around the world are trying now to stimulate somehow the economy, putting in place quite big packets, measures or in terms of impact to stimulate the economy and to help the economy to weather better the difficult period we are facing now. And still, the economies are very affected by the crisis, and this is reflected in the forecasts. For instance, we expect for Romania minus 7% for this year, which is quite drastic, I would say. And then we expect a recovery next year, plus 4.5%, which is good, but still we'll see in the next graphs that basically the level of economic activity from 2019 will be reached only in 2021. So we expect the economic recovery to be just gradual, and most likely a lot of sectors will be still affected in medium term, not only in short term. Yeah, you can see from the table, for instance, that most of the countries in Europe are quite dramatically hit by the crisis. I would say that Romania most likely will have one of the biggest impact, and I will explain why in the next slides. Yeah, even the Western countries will be strongly hit by the crisis, especially Germany. Euro area, minus 6.5% is our forecast within the Raiffeisen Group. But you saw that already ECB, for instance, is projecting even a sharper decrease in GDP in Eurozone. The budget deficit, of course, is expected to jump significantly in all the countries around the globe. And in Romania, we have a forecast for the budget deficit to reach 8.5% of GDP, which is significantly above the official target of the government, which is still 6.7%, which in my view is unrealistic. That target was based on a very optimistic assumption on GDP. They are projecting, I mean, the government is projecting minus 1.9% contraction in GDP, versus our minus 7% or versus minus 6% the forecast of the European Commission, minus 5% the forecast of the IMF. So most of the analysts or independent institutions are forecasting now between, I would say, minus 5 and minus 9% contraction for our economy in 2020. The deficit is expected again to jump significantly, driven mainly by the contraction of the economy, but also by the increase in spending, especially the healthcare spending is increasing significantly, and also the spending of the government with the technical unemployment is also important for the budgets in all the countries, especially in Europe. And in the end, the deficit in Romania is expected to increase significantly versus last year. But what is important to mention as well is that in terms of delta, in terms of increase of deficit versus last year, we are starting from more than 4% last year. And I think in terms of fiscal stimulus or additional deficit for 2020, the additional stimulus is not so high versus the other countries, as the starting point in Romania is not so favorable. So basically, the starting point for Romania is a very high deficit for 2019, and this is why actually our government is not able to implement a large-scale package in terms of fiscal stimulus, as the fiscal space is quite low. So the government in Romania has just a limited room to support the economy. And that is reflected in the package they already decided to implement. So in terms of stimulus or governmental measures aimed to support the economy, we can split the measures in two. First of all, measures with a direct budgetary impact. And in Romania, we have just 1.5% of GDP, which is low versus the other countries in Europe. But that is explained once again by the fact that the starting point in Romania is extremely high. So last year, the deficit was 4.6% of GDP. And there is no, I think there is the room to go significantly higher is limited by the constraint, the funding constraint. So we cannot go too high with the deficit, as the markets will not cover most likely a deficit higher than 8-9% of GDP. And this is why the government should try in the next months to keep the deficit under control somehow, not to let the deficit to go significantly above 7-8% of GDP, because the funding will be quite difficult. As the market perception is not so good for Romania, fortunately you saw that S&P decided to keep our rating, but I think that was a very close call, or it was a tough decision, and probably for time being S&P just decided to postpone the downgrade. So they have a negative outlook for Romania for a while, and they need to come up with a decision. And probably they got some promises from the government that the government, first of all, will not increase pensions with 40%, which is crucial in the discussion. And secondly, after elections, the government to embark on a downward trend for the deficit in order to put the fiscal finances or the public finances in order. In terms of the second category of measures without a direct budgetary impact, such as state guarantees, again, Romania is not comparing very well with the other countries in Europe, and I think that is a pity. We can expand more the measures with no budget, direct budgetary impact, such as state guarantees, and there is more room for maneuver in that respect. The government is extending now the state guarantees scheme for large companies. They started with SMEs, and now they are extending for that package for large companies as well. Okay, going to the next slide. So the main issue with the policy, public policy in Romania, is the lack of fiscal space. As again, the starting point is not so good. We had the highest deficit in Europe in 2019 at more than 4% of GDP, 4.6% of GDP actually, coming from just 1.4% of GDP in 2015. So we had a sharp increase in the budget deficit in the last couple of years, driven mainly by the measures implemented by the previous government in the last couple of years, both on the revenue side and on the expenditure side as well. If we make a calculation, actually the deficit increased in between 2015 and 19 with 3.3 percentage points of GDP. 2 percentage points are explained by the revenue side. The government cut VAT during that period, and they cut excises at the same time, and they lost revenues. Of course, eventually the revenues were lower. And at the same time, on the spending side, spending increased with 1.3 percentage points of GDP, driven mainly by the public sector wages, which increased with 2.5 percentage points of GDP during 2015-2019. Social benefits increased as well with 0.4 percentage points of GDP. And at the same time, the government, the previous government, decided to cut investments with 1.6% of GDP, and they cut the goods and services, the acquisitions in the public sector, with 0.6% of GDP. So the fiscal slippage from the last years was driven by the cut in taxes plus an increase in spending. And I think one important mention is to look at the structure of spending as well. Spending is now more biased on the social side and less on investments. So the government increased in the last years public sector wages, reaching historical highs at close to 12% of GDP. Public sector wages are now close to 12% of GDP. The previous high was reached in 2009-2010 at 10% of GDP. During the IMF agreements, during the previous financial crisis, the government succeeded to cut the wage bill from 10% of GDP to 8% of GDP, and now we are at 12% of GDP, which is a historical high, and significantly higher than the European averages. The European average for public sector wages is less than 10% of GDP, but we should have in mind the fact that the budget envelope in Romania is much lower. The tax revenues, the so-called fiscal revenues in Romania, revenues from taxes are accounting just for 27% of GDP in Romania versus 40% of GDP in Europe. So out of 27% of GDP budget revenues, we are paying 12% of GDP wages. The European average is 40% for budget revenues, and they are paying just 10% of GDP for public sector wages. Going to the next slide, of course, because the deficit increased significantly in the pre-crisis period, at the onset of the crisis in Romania, the budget was extremely vulnerable, and once the crisis hit the economy, the budget revenues decreased significantly. In March, there was a sharp decrease in revenues, more than 30% decrease versus February. In April, there was a recovery. Some companies postponed the tax payments in March, and they paid their taxes in April. But still, if we make an average of March and April, still the budget revenues are lower, significantly lower than in the previous months. The budget deficit consequently increased significantly for the first four months until April. We had a 2.5% of GDP budget deficit versus just 1.1% of GDP last year. So the deficit for April is extremely high already. And if we just extrapolate the situation from the first 4 months until year end, the deficit can reach more than 8-9% of GDP at the end of the year if the government will not try to keep under control spending, or if they will not try to limit the deficit somehow. Going to the next slide. Actually, the fiscal policy in Romania is not a new problem. It's an old problem for our country. And unfortunately, no lesson was learned from the previous crisis. So in the previous crisis, we had the same situation. If you remember, in 2008, the deficit in Romania was extremely high when the economy was booming. In 2008, we had close to 10% of GDP, 10% sorry, GDP growth, and the deficit was more than 5% of GDP. In 2019, we have more than 4% GDP growth, and the deficit was more than 4%, 4.6% of GDP. So the deficit increased in Romania in the booming period, which is against the textbooks. And the situation now, we are facing a similar situation versus the previous crisis with no fiscal space, as the deficit was already extremely high during the booming period of the economy. So what happened when the crisis hit Romania in March and April? We had a sharp adjustment in most of the indicators. We have only indicators for March and some indicators for April already, but the indicators for March were extremely bad already. Keep in mind that March was affected just in the second part of the month. The emergency crisis was enforced in the middle of March, if I remember correctly. And the first 2 months of the year, January and February, were quite good in terms of economic indicators, with a strong increase in industrial output, in services, in construction, and so on. But March was extremely bad. Overall, the first quarter was already negative, although the first 2 months were quite good. The first quarter performance was negative in industry, in services. Only in construction sector, the situation or the growth remained positive in the first quarter. Retail sales remained positive as well, as even in March, the retail sales was good. Everybody bought everything in order to face better the crisis. But in April, the retail sales collapsed. decreased with, I think, if I remember correctly, more than 20% month on month, seasonally adjusted. We expect the indicators in the second quarter to deteriorate sharply. Actually, for the second quarter, we have more than minus 15% quarter-on-quarter GDP contraction. And then, starting with the third quarter, assuming no second wave of contagion, probably GDP will start recovering in the third quarter, and the trend will be maintained in the next, in the quarters to come. Again, in the first quarter, the economy performed still okay due to the
I lost sound.
Me too. I think it's a problem with the speaker.
Yeah, sound is gone.
Is that the metro? Irina, ne poți ajuta tu?
Da, o acum în telefon. Două secunde.
Ok, mulțumim frumos.
Maybe in between we can place a question concerning the high increase of the public wages. So I think that would be an interesting point to understand a bit closer how this could happen and what is the driver, because from an investor point of view, that is a very poisonous measure.
We agree with you, Mr. Fishing. We'll address the question at the Q&A session.
Yeah.
It was covered a little bit by Mr. Dumitru, but we'll get back to it.
Yeah. It's your problem,
you. Mr. Dumitru is right. Is trying to reconnect now. Okay. Maybe 2 minutes, if we can wait.
Okay, no problem.
Thank you.
Sorry, everyone, for this. It happens.
Yes, sorry. Technical issues.
No problem.
Okay, you can see my screen.
Yes.
I suppose, yeah. Okay. So going to. Yes, this is, I think, the.
We are at this at the just a moment at the 10 slide.
Okay, just 1 second.
Yes. Maybe if we close the presentation and start the screen sharing again. Yeah.
Yes, that I will do that.
Thank you.
Okay, cool. Okay, so we are back again.
Yeah.
Basically, yeah, our projection again is -7 for this year, 3.5 in 22, but still I think the recovery is just a gradual one. It will be most likely a V-shaped recovery if there will be no second wave of contagion, but still the level of economic activity of 2019 will be reached only in 2022. So it will take quite a while to recover the economic activity or to reach the economic activity from 2019. Some sectors will be still highly impacted by the crisis in the next quarters and probably even in the years to come. Romania is a bit protected by some structural indicators we are having, such as the share of sectors which are not affected too much by COVID. For instance, in Romania, the services sector is lower than in other countries. The tourism sector is significantly lower than in other countries, and that should provide a kind of a safety net for our country. The trade openness for Romania is significantly lower than in other countries in Europe, and we all know that one of the effects of the crisis was the disruption in supply chain, especially the goods which are coming from abroad were affected, and Romania is having a lower share of exports plus imports in terms of percent of GDP versus the other countries. Romania is having a lower share of SME sector in the total economy, and SMEs were the most affected companies. And we are having, for instance, a higher food consumption versus the other countries in Europe, and food demand was the least affected. But still, what we miss completely is the fiscal space. So we have a structure of the economy which is protecting us somehow in this crisis, but at the same time we have a big vulnerability, which is the lack of fiscal space, as the deficit was already increased in the previous years, and there is no space or no significant space left to expand the deficit to stimulate the economy. And this is why we expect a bigger impact of the crisis in Romania than in other countries in Europe. So probably the recovery in Romania will be just gradual, as the fiscal space, once again, is much lower than in other countries in Europe. It's a different story if you are starting from a surplus in the budget, like in Germany, for instance, which had surpluses for a couple of years already in the previous years. Like Czech Republic, for instance, or even Bulgaria. And it's a completely different story if we are starting from 4.6% of GDP budget deficit like Romania in 2019. Inflation is not an issue for time being. We expect inflation to decrease a bit in the next months towards 2.4% in May, and then to remain in a range of 2.4-3% until year end. We have two opposite forces impacting inflation now. One is the low oil price, which is keeping inflation low. And the second one is the higher food price, which is pushing inflation higher. The food price is increasing everywhere, not only in Romania. Particularly in Romania, we have a very bad harvest for 2020, extremely bad, I would say, especially in some areas of big areas of the country, and that will keep the food price pressure quite strong. The central bank decided to cut rates already in two meetings. And we have now a 1.75% key policy rate, which is a record low for Romania. So they cut rates with 75 basis points starting when the crisis starting, or since the crisis hit Romania, from 2.50. They are injecting liquidity through repo operations, and they are buying treasury securities, a form of QE, quantitative easing. So they are buying treasury securities in the secondary market in order to help the funding of the economy and to inject liquidity in the economy. They cut reserve requirement, or they are ready to cut reserve requirements if needed. Currently, reserve requirements are still high versus the European averages, 8% in local currency, 6% in foreign currency, versus less than 2% in most of the European countries. So there is some space left in terms of monetary easing. But I think the space for maneuver in terms of monetary easing is not so large versus the other countries are as the macro situation in Romania is not so good versus most of the countries in Europe. We have still a twin deficit situation. We have a big budget deficit together with a big current account deficit, and that is not allowing the central bank to be more aggressive with the monetary policy. I think the currency was extremely stable versus the other currencies in the region, especially compared with Polish zloty or Hungarian forint, which depreciated in 2020 quite significantly. For instance, the Hungarian forint depreciated at some point with more than 15% versus 2019. Polish zloty with more than 5%. Our currency was extremely stable, as the central bank is quite focused on exchange rate stability. But still, the fundamentals of the currency are not so good. And we think that from the fundamentals point of view, the currency should depreciate. Our projections are showing a gradual depreciation of the currency, 4.90 in June. Maybe this June forecast is a bit pessimistic, but I think the currency should depreciate. We have a 5 euro RON at the end of the year. Our currency was extremely stable in the last years, although the twin deficit situation deteriorated. So the current account deficit increased, exports increased faster than imports. Imports increased faster than exports, and the trade balance deteriorated. And at the same time, the currency was quite stable in nominal terms, which means that in real terms, having in mind the fact that inflation in Romania was significantly higher than in Eurozone, in real terms, the currency appreciated quite significantly. In the last 5 years, our currency in real terms appreciated with more than 10%. Which is not good at all for the external competitiveness, especially in relative terms, especially versus Hungarian forint or Polish zloty, for instance. Our currency appreciated quite significantly versus Hungarian forint and Polish zloty, in real terms especially. And that is not good for our trade balance situation. We are importing a lot of stuff from Hungary and Poland as well. So we are still projecting a depreciation of the currency. For time being, the central bank is still very focused on the currency, but at some point they should let the currency to depreciate, not too sharp, but I think there should be a gradual depreciation, and I think that trend cannot be avoided. Especially having in mind that the external position indicators are not so good, or the external position is deteriorating. First of all, the current account deficit increased significantly in the last years. The funding of the current account with so-called healthy flows, such as EU funds and FDIs, are the coverage of the current account with such kind of flows is not so good anymore, decreased below 100% in the last 2 years. And the external debt is not so low. And actually, the coverage of external debt, short, especially the short-term external debt with international reserve of the National Bank, is not so high anymore. So I think, again, from the fundamental point of view, the currency should depreciate. And for time being, the central bank is defending the currency. Probably they are trying to remain neutral in an electoral year, but probably after elections, they will let the currency to depreciate. Actually, that was a common pattern in the last 20 plus years in Romania. That was my presentation. Should go now to the Q&A section. I will stop the sharing.
On behalf of our attendees, I would like to thank you for this insightful presentation.
Welcome.
We already have a question on the chat, and I will invite now Mr. Fishing to address his question.
Please.
Yeah, Yeah, so Mr. Dumitru, thank you very much for very inspiring and content-wise interesting information. So I think I share with you that development is quite critical, and we have to see that financial deficits need to come under control. Also having in mind that we want a change to euro sometimes in the future. Yeah. But when what you said about public wages is of course very embarrassing, not to say annoying effect. So could you elaborate a bit on that? Because if the public wages are increasing or skyrocketing, that's not a real investor-friendly measure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so first of all, public sector wages were increased continuously in the last couple of years, starting with 2015 especially. So Romania had a big big issue with the deficit and with the budget in general in the previous financial crisis. In 2009-2010, in 2010 actually the government, if you remember, cut wages with 25% in the public sector. And then the wages in the public sector for a couple of years decreased as a percent of GDP from a peak of 10% in 2009-2010 to less than 8% in 2015. Starting with 15-16, the public sector wages increased quite sharply. And now we are close to 12% of GDP, which is, I think, a big issue. Public sector wages are now significantly higher than private sector wages. In terms of relative wages, public administration in Romania, I mean the ratio between public sector or public administration wages versus the average in the economy, our public administration in Romania is the best paid in Europe, if you can imagine that. The wages in public administration in Romania are something like 60% higher than the average wage in the economy.
Is there some plan to change, or so every investor coming to Romania will be shocked? And that's
looking at the experience from the previous financial crisis, with the political cost of the party cutting wages in 2010, I think no political party will cut wages anymore in Romania. What we can hope for the next years is to keep under control the wage bill in the public sector. So not to cut public sector wages, but not to increase the bill anymore, and to keep the bill increase lower than GDP growth, and to have an adjustment of the bill in a couple of years from now in relative terms versus GDP. But otherwise, I think I'm not naive and I'm quite realistic. No political party will cut wages in the public sector, and I'm afraid no political party will adjust the number of employees in the public sector significantly. What we can hope is to keep the bill low versus GDP growth.
Yeah, and at the same time, we could have a co-financing via European Union, but historically, Romania is somehow weak in taking advantage of funds already attributed to Romania, so like for the highways. What's your expectation for the big funds now done for Corona recovery?
So I think Romania has now a huge opportunity. You saw probably the latest measures at the European level. The last measure is a 750 billion euros package, which is coming on top of the regular EU funds. Romania has a very good allocation in that package, so we can benefit of more than 30 billion euros in terms of net, because we need to pay a contribution to that package. We should have, I think, 21 or 22 billion euros, which is in top five beneficiaries at European level. So EU funds, which are accounting for more than 30 billion euros for Romania. We have another 30 plus billion euros in that new package. So we have for the next financial package, 2021-2027, a double amount versus the previous financial package. If we are smart enough, we can take advantage of that and we can start the big infrastructure projects. But I think we need to have smart politicians and good project management skills.
Yeah, and that's a vital point because we have, like you said, highly overpaid staff and are not able to manage public projects. So that is really an issue.
Yeah. Okay.
We have
the industry side do something to improve this situation. So what would be your advice to safeguard these funds?
I think we have now a unique opportunity, if you ask me, even from the political point of view. We have elections this year in 2020, local and general elections. We should see how the elections will be organized, but normally there should be elections until year end, and then in the next 4 years until 2024, there are no elections anymore. So we have a unique window of opportunity in Romania with no elections in the next 4 years. In the past, we used to have quite a busy electoral agenda with European Parliament elections, local elections, general elections, presidential elections, and unfortunately, one of the worst decisions in Romania was to split the presidential mandate in Romania and the parliament mandate. The president has a 5-year mandate and the parliament a 4-year mandate. And you can imagine that we have a lot of election years. Now we have a window of opportunity ahead of us with 4 years with no elections. A good government can take advantage of that. Having 4 years ahead, they can progress a lot in terms of structural reforms without the election pressure on them. Okay.
We have some other questions on the chat. Mr. Chat Shaft is asking you to tell us more about the development of unemployment this year.
Okay, so the unemployment in Romania, of course, is increasing, but please keep in mind that the unemployment number in Romania is understated, and not only in Romania, is understated. Basically, the so-called technical unemployment is not recorded in the unemployment numbers. But still, even without technical unemployment, the unemployment should increase as the economy will face quite a difficult period going forward. But if the economy will recover rapidly, or starting with the third quarter, the economic activity will start picking up once again, probably the peak in unemployment will be at around 7%, I think we have at the end of the year. Could this lockdown period fire up a sovereign debt crisis? Of course, everywhere the deficit is increasing significantly. If you are just looking to United States, for instance, the deficit is projected to reach 15-16% of GDP, and the public debt is expected to go higher with something like 20 plus percentage points of GDP just in 2020. But I think that kind of situation is not possible everywhere. In US, they can afford that because the dollar has the privilege to be, let's say, preferred by investors globally. The dollar assets are important in every portfolio in terms of investments. And countries like Romania cannot afford that. So the main issue for countries like Romania is the funding issue. So we cannot run deficits of 10 plus percent of GDP because nobody will finance that. But of course, the debt, the sovereign debt, would increase significantly everywhere, and probably that will be the next issue to face in the next years. But yeah, for time being, everybody's concerned how to restart the economies, and they are not paying too much attention on public debt trajectory in medium to long term.
Thank you. Another question from Mr. Florin Grossu. Could this lockdown period fire up a sovereign debt crisis? When can this happen? And what could be the effect? Yeah. Please.
Yeah, I partially answered to that. Of course, the sovereign debt will increase. Once again, I mentioned that. But I think nobody is focused on that for time being. So everybody is trying to implement quite large fiscal packages in order to stimulate the economy. Look at Germany, for instance. But Germany has, again, a good situation, having surpluses or running surpluses in the budget in the previous years. And they can afford to go with a deficit at 8-9% of GDP. They can implement quite large fiscal stimulus. And fortunately, that will be very helpful for countries like Romania. Romania is exporting more than 22-23% total exports to Germany. And if Germany will implement a large-scale fiscal stimulus, that will drag, or that will help the European economy in general, and Romania in particular.
Is anyone having questions? Please raise your hand or just unmute your microphone. Thank you.
I have a question. I'm Florin Grossu. Thank you for your answer, Mr. Dumitru. I was thinking, how do you assess the amplitude of the European stimulus? Do you think that it's too important even for Europe, considering that we didn't end it yet, the last QE, which took a lot?
Yeah, so to be honest, I was surprised positively by the response of the European institutions during COVID crisis. So they learned some lessons from the previous financial crisis. If you remember, in the previous financial crisis, the response of the European Commission, the European authorities in general, was quite difficult and delayed. Now they came up with a quite large package quite rapidly, not only in terms of monetary stimulus, but also fiscal stimulus. There are a lot of programs started in the last weeks at the European level to support technical unemployment, to support the economies in general. They are now trying to mutualize partially the debt. That 750 billion euros package will be funded also through issuance in the markets in the name of the European Commission, which is a AAA institution, not in the name of individual countries, which is a very good thing for more exposed countries such as Greece, Italy, Spain, even Romania. I think it's much better for countries in the periphery, let's say, of the European Union to have a common issuance at the European level. Of course, there are a lot of debates on that. There is no final decision taken. There should be a validation in all the countries until year end. But still, I think it's a big step ahead from my point of view. And I think in the end, Europe learned some lessons from the previous crisis, which is good, I would say.
Thank you. If I may, I have a collateral question. To which extent do you think that this monetary policy will vanquish or will reach its capability? Because sooner or later the bill needs to be paid, and this is just a delay with the stimulus which is happening.
So the QE, the quantitative easing, is actually printing money. we all know based on the textbooks that printing money is not good for the economy, that will create inflation in medium to long term. But to be honest, nobody pays attention to medium to long term. Everybody is focused on how to help somehow the economies in short term. And there, if you are looking to the balance sheet of Federal Reserve in US or ECB in Europe, they are expanding dramatically their balance sheets. So they are buying assets and they are injecting liquidity to help the economy. In the end, probably the key will be how fast they can stop that stimulus and how fast they can sterilize the liquidity they will inject when the economy will start the recovery. And if they will be able to sterilize the liquidity in due time in order to avoid the high inflation risk. What percent of increase of pensions can we afford in order to not to be downgraded? I think, the pension increase is key for the country rating. Why? First of all, the 40% has a huge budgetary impact. 40%, I think, was completely unsustainable even in normal times. In particular, in such a situation we are facing now, it's impossible to increase pensions with 40%. I think it will be completely insane to increase pensions with 40% when the economy is decreasing with 7%. So I think pensions should increase. Most likely the government will consider something like 10% increase in pensions. If you ask me, pensions should be increased automatically each and every year based on the formula they introduced, a couple of years ago. There is an indexation scheme of the pensions, inflation plus part of the real wage increase in the economy, and that should be an automatic process, I would say. The pension increase in Romania is highly politicized. It's a political issue. Actually, they suspended the indexation scheme and they want to increase pensions on a discretionary basis. Instead of increasing pensions automatically starting 1st of January with inflation from the previous years plus part of the real wage increase, they are deciding on a discretionary basis how much they will increase pensions, and of course that is not good. But to answer the questions about the rating, basically I think the rating is still at risk. All the three rating agencies are keeping a negative outlook for Romania. According with their methodologies, in the foreseeable, I think, in the next 2 years maximum, they should come with a decision, either to change the outlook or to downgrade the country. If the situation is improving, they can change the outlook to stable once again, or they can, if the situation is not improving, they can cut the rating. I think it will be key, first of all, how much pensions will be increased starting 1st of September. And secondly, what will happen after elections? I think nobody is naive to think that before elections, somebody will start the adjustment of the budget. But after elections, I think the government, irrespective of the government after elections, they should cut the deficit. We cannot afford to run deficits at 7, 8, 9% or even 11%, which is projected, by the way, by the European Commission for next year. The European Commission is projecting more than 9% deficit this year and 11 point something next year. That is too much, far too much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dumitru. Okay. I invite the attendees once again to take their chance and address their questions.
So, no more questions?
It seems that we covered it all.
Okay.
Thank you once again for your time.
You're welcome. Thank you. Thank you as well.
Okay, for have a nice day. This for us.
Okay, have a nice day.
Have a great day, everyone. Thank you for joining us today.
Bye.